Mario Bravo. I work for Environmental Defense Fund on air quality and climate change issues. Environmental Defense Fund is a national or international nonprofit based out of the U.S. We have offices in Austin, in Denver, in San Francisco, in Boston, D.C., New York. And so I work here full-time in San Antonio. I'm based out of the Austin office, so I check in with them about once every 2 weeks, but I work here and in the Eagle Ford Shale region. And so today I want to talk to you about air quality and climate challenges and opportunities in San Antonio. It's going to be mostly focused on air quality, but there's definitely a connection between that and climate change, which we're going to get into today. And it's great, it's always nice to see familiar faces, but I also see a lot of new faces here, so that's exciting too, so I'm glad you all came. So, I've been giving this presentation recently to younger children, and what I have, I love to ask them about their grades. You know, what kind of grades do you get? What kind of grades do you want to get? And I said, do you know that our city and our county gets a grade on its air quality? So the American Lung Association gives out grades on air quality, and you can see here that this report came out last year that Bexar County got an F. And when I started following air quality here in San Antonio, I started looking at what does the public discussion look like on air quality? What are we seeing in the news? How does the media talk about this? And you'll see here some of these headlines. Everyone can help reduce ozone pollution. Barely in compliance now, San Antonio will have to lower ozone pollution. Proposed EPA ozone rules will damage economy. EPA overreach based on politics. Stricter ozone standards would hit agriculture hard. What are some themes that you see there?
Ozone,
right? What else?
Opposition and support.
Yeah. What's that?
Opposition and support.
Anything else?
There's a monetary value to this.
Monetary value to this, right? What is missing from that?
Health.
Right. So why does the EPA regulate ozone? So exposure to ground level ozone can harm your respiratory system. It can lead to reduced lung function. It aggravates asthma and other respiratory illnesses. It has harmful effects on both short-term and long-term exposure. So you can just be exposed to it a short amount of time and it can still reduce your lung function. And it's linked to premature death from respiratory and cardiovascular causes. So how much premature death? Well, there was a study that came out last year by the American Thoracic Society at NYU that said that 52 people in San Antonio die prematurely every year from our poor air quality. NYU and the American Thoracic Society. That came out last year. And you can link to it, I think, through this news story by Brendan Goons. And then if you look right here, down here it says, Councilman says he'll seek funding for a health study. Who wants to guess who that councilman was?
Ron.
It was Ron, yeah, before he became mayor. What you'll see is...
He did get it,
and I emailed Liza Meyer with the Office of Sustainability. She's in charge of air quality for the city. I emailed her this morning. I said, hey, what's the story with that health study? When's it coming out? And she said, I have a final copy in my hand now, and she said she does not have a release date. So, I don't know. I think it's supposed to come out this month. But, yeah, what happened was the TCEQ funded a study, and if you go back, you'll remember... Look at these headlines. Proposed EPA ozone rules will damage economy. That's a lot of what we heard people talking about before. So TCEQ said, okay, we want to do an economic impact study. What is it going to cost our region to go into non-attainment? And so when they did, we said, okay, but let's look at the full economic picture because there's going to be cost to businesses, right, to reduce their pollution, but there's health cost savings, right? And so let's look at the whole thing. And TCEQ said, no, we're not going to pay for that. We just want to know the cost of taxes. And so we went. It was myself and probably Peter Bella in the back of the room over there and Crystal Hennigan with Montclean Air Force and Anna Sandoval, who was back then. She was the executive director of Air Health Collaborative. We all went to Councilman Nierenberg at the time and we made the case for why we needed this. And he said, okay. And he got $75,000 funded for it. So hopefully we'll get to see it this month. But what is ozone exactly? Okay, so I know some people are going to see this and say, oh no, are we going to do some chemistry? Well, just a little bit. Bear with me, right? So ozone occurs when nitrogen oxide and VOCs, when they meet in the presence of sunlight. So sunlight is the catalyst. So nitrogen oxides, we call them NOx for short. Volatile organic compounds, we call them VOCs for short. They interact in the presence of sunlight and form ozone, which is O3. So the oxygen we breathe is O2. O3 is much less, it's very unstable. It's very reactive, right? It's an oxidizer. So when you think of rust is oxidizing, right? So what happens to the metal, to the iron? It also is used, you hear about ozone being used to purify water, right? Because it kills everything in the water that's alive, right? So do you want that reacting in your lungs? Probably not. So what are NOx and what are VOCs? Well, NOx are the result of any time you burn a fuel. So when I say fuel, it's like, okay, when I put gasoline in my car, drive down the road, I'm burning that gasoline, right? So NOx are coming out of my tailpipe. If I am burning firewood in my house, NOx are coming out my chimney. If I barbecue charcoal briquettes in my backyard, right, NOx are going to come out of that. So it's burning fuels. Then VOCs, that's when something that an organic chemical is very volatile when it evaporates easily at room temperature or normal temperatures. So gasoline can produce NOx or VOCs, because gasoline, it can be, when you burn it, it's going to form NOx. But VOCs, think about when you're gassing up your car and you see that wavy little gas coming up right there, right? Those are VOCs. It's volatile. It's evaporating at normal temperatures. When you paint with an oil-based paint, it dries very quickly, fast drying paints, right? And those are VOCs that are evaporating. When you take your clothes to the dry cleaner, they clean them in a VOC solution, they pull them out, and they're instantly dry because it evaporates very quickly. So when those chemicals interact in the presence of sunlight, then you're going to form that unstable molecule ozone. And you can see here healthy lungs, and in lungs that have been on the right have been exposed to ozone, so you can see how they've been affected there. So if you're my age or older, you probably have also heard things about ozone that makes you think, well, we need ozone, right? And that's because we want ozone up in the upper levels of the atmosphere, because it protects us from ultraviolet light from the sun, right? And so you might have heard about holes in the ozone layer, and that's a problem, right? It is a problem. We want to make sure that we keep ozone up there to protect us from the ultraviolet light. But, so we say it's good up high, but it's bad nearby, because it's such an unstable reactive molecule, we don't want to breathe it into our lungs. So we don't want it at the ground level. So we mentioned that it can trigger asthma, right? So what is the prevalence of asthma here in Texas? 7.3% of adults have asthma. About 9% of children have asthma. And more importantly, here in Bexar County, we have the highest rate of children who have to go to the emergency room for asthma attacks. So this is something that's definitely affecting our health. So I talked a little bit about sources of ozone-forming emissions. Oil and gas activities, that's going to be both VOCs and NOx. I'll get into that a little bit. Cement manufacturing, they burn a lot of fuel. It's very energy intensive to produce cement, and we have a lot of cement production here in the Bexar County region. On-road vehicles, ports and ship channels, so like Port San Antonio, where we have all the trains coming through. Then there's regional transport from other cities, right? So on days when we exceed the federal standards for ozone, about two-thirds of the ozone is coming from outside of our region. And you'll hear a lot of people complain about that and say, well, it's out of our control. We can't do anything about it because most of it's coming from somebody else, right? But sometimes, we might blame it on Houston or Austin or Dallas. But sometimes our ozone is blowing over to their city and it's increasing their levels too, right? So if we don't do something about our ozone production, our ozone precursor emissions, we can't ask them really or expect them to do something about theirs. Then there's electricity generation, whether it's burning coal or natural gas. Auto body shops, there's a lot of paint evaporating there, and dry cleaners, I mentioned those. So we're about to go into non-attainment. What does that cost, right? Or the cost to comply, cost to industry to reduce the pollution, cost to drivers for additional vehicle inspections and maintenance. That depends on what level of non-attainment you go into. Cost to local government for staff time, for more planning, more compliance. That's what I was talking about. That was all compiled by TCEQ. Now, that came out, I don't know, just a few months ago. The study was done by the Saavedra Institute at St. Mary's University. And that study said, it gave a humongous window. It was like anywhere from 100 million to, or no, was it 10 million to $1 billion a year is what it could cost us? Yeah, it was like a hundredfold factor of what it could cost us. And it didn't make a lot of sense to me because they were essentially saying it could cost San Antonio or Bexar County over $1 billion a year to comply. Right. Well, the EPA had already done a study on this because the EPA can't pass a big law like this or new regulations like this without doing some kind of an economic study to say what is the impact, what are the benefits, and what is the impact going to be on the community. And that study said it was going to cost the entire nation $2.5 billion to comply. So how is it possible that Texas alone would be $1 billion? And the other question that comes to mind is that when the EPA did the study, they said that we were going to have the savings, the health cost savings from cleaning up our air was actually going to be several times what the cost to comply with standard would be. So that's why I'm really eager to see what is this study going to say that hopefully we'll get to see later this month.
Excuse me. Who funded that St. Mary's University study?
That was the TCEQ. TCEQ gave money to ACOG, and ACOG hired the Saavedra Institute at St. Mary's University. And they spent $35,000 on the study, so it was really not enough money to do a good study.
Say the name slower. I've never heard of
it. Saavedra? Like, it's like Saber.
S-A-B-E-R?
S-A-B-E-R. Saber.
Correct. See, but again, it seems to me that this is really taking into consideration only some of the economic factors. The EPA included the health as a this was totally different.
Right, that's why we went to Ron Ehrenberg at the time and said, hey, you know, we're only seeing one side of the economic picture here. We need to see both in order to have a complete picture. Luckily, you know, he had been at the time he was the chair of the Air Improvement Resources Executive Committee at ACOG. So he understood this problem, understood the importance of it, and was willing to get that money put in. I think that was in the mid-year budget adjustment that we got it in last year. Go ahead.
Do you know if the study says who pays?
Who pays what's
the cost? Yes. Yeah. Who is really assuming the cost? Do you know
if
the study talks about it in those terms?
I don't know. I would assume that a lot of the big emissions producers are aware of who it could affect for the most part. But I'll get into that a little bit more about what the marginal non-attainment can look like here. So what are the cost savings associated with cleaning our air? I touched on this, but it's less hospital bills. Right? If you don't have an asthma attack, you don't have to go to the hospital. It could be lower insurance rates. If our entire region doesn't have this health problem as much, then our health insurance rates can go down for the region, right? There's less missed work days. So if your kid has an asthma attack and you have to take the day off from work, then you could lose wages that day. Let's miss school day. So for every day that there's a student that's not in that public school because they had some health episode, that school's not going to get federal dollars for having student that. So they miss out on that federal funding. So that's what hopefully will be released later this month. So non-attainment designation, that's supposed to happen in October of this year. And the EPA said, no, we're going to push it back a year. Then they changed their mind and said, no, okay, we are going to do it this year. It's supposed to happen October 1st, but October 1st is a Sunday, so I'm guessing that we're going to find out on October 2nd. We are expected to be designated marginal non-attainment. And so that's the very lowest level of non-attainment. And so one big, that does not require us to do vehicle inspections where they do a tailpipe emissions test. So that's it's still going to be optional. What you will see is if a business wants to expand in marginal non-attainment, after they expand, they have to have reduced their emissions by 10%. So if you want to double in size, after you've doubled in size, whatever your factory is, after you've doubled it in size, afterward, your total emissions are going to have to be 10% less than what they were before you doubled in size. So the only way you're going to get there is through saying maybe you were taking electricity off the grid, instead you're going to have a lot of solar panels on your roof, maybe you're going to do different things for energy efficiency, like more energy efficient, you know, adding insulation, more energy efficient windows. Maybe you can do it by getting your employees to maybe start a carpool program and encourage, maybe you give out a few bus passes to all of your employees and so get some of them to ride the bus more and reduce their carbon footprints or their emissions profiles.
I have a question.
Sure.
How what is the regulatory mechanism to enforce that? I mean, so, like, how does that work?
I don't know the specifics of that.
Okay.
Yeah. Go. Well, we got Peter in the back who might be able to help. Do you guys know who Peter Bell is? Peter used to be the Natural Resources Director for the Alamo Area Council of Governments. And so
I used to do this stuff. I retired in 2014. But the answer to your question is there's a process. It's called SIP creditable. You're required to make SIP creditable reductions that have to be calculated. In other words, you have to show how you're going to do it, and the calculation has to be a calculation that EPA and TCEQ both agree with. And also, very importantly, they have to be enforceable. There has to be someone, either the state of Texas, typically the state of Texas, perhaps in some cases EPA, but there has to be an enforcement requirement so that you have to not only show that you're going to make so many tons of reduction, but you're going to have to guarantee that they exist, and you're going to have oversight to make sure they do happen. And if those criteria aren't met, you don't qualify.
Is it SEIP?
SIP.
Yeah, State Implementation Plan.
Oh.
So is that for like air release permitting?
It has to do when he showed the non-attainment, what happens under a marginal non-attainment classification. What he showed there were bullets that go with different emission types, and those emission types have those kind of rules that go with them.
Other questions? So our non-attainment designation is likely only going to be Bexar County, not surrounding counties. Does anybody see the problem with that?
Yeah.
Right, air moves.
Yeah. Also, our SMSA extends past Bexar County, right?
Right. So, yeah, I mean, we have a 13-county MSA, I believe.
Lost County.
And that's Metropolitan Statistical Area. And so, if you know, air quality is a regional issue. It doesn't stay confined to political boundaries. And so, we need a regional approach to fix it. And so if Bexar County has limitations on any kind of emissions and any kind of growth, then people can just build their factories all just outside of Bexar County in the surrounding counties, and we're still going to get their emissions.
So the Alamo Area Council of Governments involves more than Bexar County, right, Peter? So it seems logical that if that's a fact, to respect the natural flow of air, that it would be approached at that level,
right,
and include the counties that are helping to produce that.
Right. And so, and that's how it's done in Houston, that's how it's done in Dallas, that's how it's done all over, it's been done all over the nation. But right now, the state has recommended only Bexar County. And because of the moving timelines, and because the new EPA under Scott Pruitt hasn't had a lot of time to analyze this, a lot of people are speculating that they're just going to take what the state recommended.
So if we added those counties, we'd be above marginal
What's that?
So if we added the counties, we'd be probably way above marginal attainment.
No, it would be the same. But so the thing is that the definition of who gets designated non-attainment is, do you have regulatory air quality monitors that have exceeded the standard, or do you have any science that demonstrates that your emissions are contributing to those monitors exceeding the standard? So if you're in a surrounding county that also is exceeding the standard or that's contributing emissions to it, then you should be part of that metropolitan statistical area that gets designated non-attainment.
How do we change that?
Maybe. We might have to sue them. I'm guessing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't want it to work.
Do you think that? Also, a lot of that air that's coming into Bexar County, if we're counting VOCs as well as NOx, is coming, previous studies have shown it's coming out of the Eagle Ford Shale, and that's a sacred cow.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody wants to touch. Sorry.
That's a good way of describing it.
Yes. And so, I mean, it's an economic state of cow.
Yep.
So, maybe that's another reason why they didn't want to go into other counties.
Maybe. So that's actually my next slide right here is let's look at the Eagle Ford Shale region. And so there's Bexar County in the green, right? And so our predominant winds blow southeast to northwest. So they blow this way. And then if you look down here, that's Karnes County. Due southeast of us, Karnes County is the heart of the Eagle Ford Shale oil and gas region. It's the most productive area. So even when prices go really low for oil and gas, there's still going to be highest readings for over a dozen hydrocarbon species. And so traditionally, the air quality monitor with the highest readings has been in Houston Ship Channel, right? Because they had really bad air there. But recently, the air quality readings in Karnes County have been more than twice as high as the readings in the Houston Ship Channel. And also, if you've been reading in the news about a lot of the emissions after Hurricane Harvey in Houston, you'll see that there were, you know, large plumes, lots of excessive emissions that were being given off while a lot of these factories were starting back up and these processing facilities. During shutdown and startup, they give off a lot more emissions. Even with that going on, the regulatory air quality monitor in Karnes County was higher than the Houston monitors that were up and running.
I think a few years ago, too, when Airlines Houston really worked with us about 10 years ago, there was an attempt to bring the Shell refinery into compliance, and that seemed to be successful. One of the things they have to do now is include a MSI monitoring system so that they can immediately see where the leaks are coming from.
Mm-hmm.
That was part of the settlement. So I think since then, the air quality in Houston has actually improved a great deal. Now, after the hurricane is another issue. But before that, and Matt Tejada was the executive director at that time, for Airlines Houston, and then he was appointed head of the Environmental Justice Division at the EPA in 2008. So,
great.
Wow. They developed a lot of really good environmental small communities in Houston to monitor their effect.
Yeah.
If I could add just two real quick points. One is I really appreciate the Airlines Houston, the work that they've done. The idea that there are NGOs, local non-governmental organizations, that have been very effective in putting their foot down when it comes to several of these efforts. And there's a map that if you take a look, there are there are dozens of air monitors in Houston for ozone and other pollutants. Part of that is obviously because it's such an industrial hub, but the idea being that we could use a lot more of that here. Right now there's not much of a network of independent but quality air quality monitors. Number two is I'm really going to be interested to see if after Harvey, because there have been so many reported upsets and so much pollution associated with the oil and gas industry in the Houston region because of Harvey, and there's a lot of call for monitoring and other measures, I'm hoping that kind of breaks a little bit more with the willingness of the state and local partners to create more monitoring. I really hope that sort of breaks that whole question open. And we can begin to do a lot more of that here in the Eagle Ford, too.
Right, even developing small environmental justice communities here.
That would be wonderful.
So we have a lot of emissions that are blowing through the county, right, because the predominant winds are going from the southeast to the northwest. One challenge we have is the number of air quality monitors that are in the Eagle Ford Shale as compared to the Barnett Shale up here in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. Now, the Eagle Ford Shale is a more productive region, but we have 1/10 as many air quality monitors, right? And so I've asked about this quite a bit, and what I'm hearing from the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality and from the EPA is that they're more focused on putting air quality monitors where the people are breathing air, as opposed to where the emissions might be coming from. And so I understand that you want air quality monitors where people are breathing air, but it seems like we could study the problem better and understand the problem better if we knew more about where those emissions are coming from, because that's a huge area to only have 3 air quality monitors.
Most of it's very sparsely populated too. However, there are more facilities and they're being located next to people's homes. And some of them in cities.
Or if you look at Collins County, they're next to the jails, they're next to the immigrant detention center, they're next to the schools, they're next to the hospital.
Yes.
When there's density in some.
And it was the local officials who had to fight for that air monitor, otherwise all the others were on the outer edge of the Eagle Ford Shale. This one's right in the middle.
Right. And I have also heard that part of, you know, they have more political clout there, you know, they have a lot, because of the population density, they have a lot more elected officials there, and so they can push for what they want. So these people, because there's less of them,
they're less well-educated.
They're less well-educated, they're lower income, and they, you know, they have less of a political voice.
Well, also, the people who work there many times welcome the industry because they're going to get the jobs.
Absolutely.
It's good for small business. It's saving a lot of communities that are dying in that sense.
Right.
So they're very reluctant to criticize even if they do find it.
Absolutely. And I think part of it is culture too, right?
Yes.
You know, if you live out in the country, you're kind of self-reliant, you don't complain about things, you tough things out, you get the job done yourself. And so that's part of that culture, but also it's, you know, if you're breathing some of these emissions, you may not speak up because your brother's feeding their family by working for them, or your father, or your cousin, or your neighbor,
right.
And so you don't want to be the person who, they're afraid that if they do speak up, that the industry could go away and they could lose their jobs.
Also, if they offend their cousins or their in-laws, they may not speak for them, they may not invite them to family or anything. It goes that deep.
Yeah, and Sister Elizabeth is down there working all the time, so she knows a lot of these families. This is, a lot of this is first-hand knowledge for her. Go ahead, Lisa.
Well, Mario, my question is, I'm trying to salvage the value of that information that's there. So in Barnett Shale, is that urban area in compliance or non-compliance?
For ozone?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're non-attainment.
So they've got non-attainment. So they've already had to pay the cost of going into non-attainment, which means we can compare our circumstance being and being whatever the situation is, and there will be costs that go. Like if we say we want 30 monitors, we'll be able to look at them and say that's what it costs to have 30 monitors, because that's the only way we're going to know whether we can afford them, populate them, and use the information that's in there. So tripping into non-payment, does that add another reason why they should increase the monitors? In other words, they've gotten away with it so far by saying we only put monitors where people are. But if we're non-attainment, then we're those people. So could we justify more monitors just for the fact that we're going into non-attainment?
Well, so we have our own air quality monitors here in Bexar County. The issue is down here in the Eagle Ford Shale, there are only 3.
But it's a 5-minute drive down to the edge of that between that margin. It's all downhill.
Yeah.
we know what an air quality monitor costs, because we have several. But Peter, do you want to weigh in on this?
First of all, the requirement for the number of air quality monitors, the requirement is based on population. That's why we have 3, because 3 regulatory monitors, because that's the population-based requirement.
Well, so oddly enough, that's an implicit acknowledgement of the health problem of air quality, even though they don't care to explicitly say
but
what we're worried about is people's.
It's regulatory, so that's it's a regulatory framework. And again, TCEQ is loath to point the finger at the Eagle Ford Shale, right, as a cause of anything bad. And that goes to some rules that while at ACOG we tried to work with them on. We tried to work with them on some funding for some emissions reductions project in the Eagle Ford. The hook was we had to show that making reductions in the Eagle Ford would lead to reductions in San Antonio, which is a very onerous task, believe me. And number two, just quickly on the idea of the history of non-attainment in other places in Texas, I believe it was the 92 Clean Air Act Amendments. Anyway, it's been like a general policy that they've been in non-attainment. So the idea of the technologies, that the sources, really in a certain sense don't exist. That is, whatever, even if it's a cement factory, what was the polluter then, the same technology, level of technology, kind of process, pretty much doesn't exist. So to simply look at them and say, number one, what did they do that made that allowed them to come closer to compliance? The same technology, the same cost, the same machinery wouldn't really fit 20, 30 years later. So it's tough to try and say, let's look at them for costs and remediation and then project it to San Antonio's case, because it's with the passage of time and the change in costs and everything else, it really is apples and oranges.
Okay.
So this brings up another issue. It's like, so who pays for the air quality work can affect what the scope of work is, right? So Texas Commission on Environmental Quality has traditionally paid the lion's share of all our air quality work, which is done at ACOG. So the problem with that is that they get to call the shots on what are the potential pollution sources that we can look at. What is, you know, how, what area are we going to study? And so that, if you're limiting what you can look at for emissions, then you're limiting what your potential outcomes can be and what you can actually be able to address.
And then they cut the funding.
Well, so they cut the funding, right? But then CPS Energy went and they said, okay, we'll pay for the air quality monitors that we have in Bexar County. There were 7 air quality monitors. There were 6 that were turned off. They turned those 6 back on, plus they are bringing one back, introducing one new air quality monitor over in Government Canyon, which is great because previously we really didn't know what was going on the west side of San Antonio very well, because we didn't have anything that was far enough west that was picking up on the northwest side, that was picking up our air quality as it would blow through the county. And so that's great that we have those 7. Then the cement and aggregates industry and the oil and gas industry, STEER, the South Texas Energy and Economic Roundtable, which represents the major oil and gas companies in the Eagle Ford Shale, they got together and they said, well, we'll pay for a lot of the air quality studies and staff time. So one problem there is, so you have a lot of the emissions producers that are paying for this air quality work, right? And so previously we had an Air Improvement Resources Advisory Committee that was made up of members of the public. Peter was on that, I was on that, Russell Seal from the Sierra Club was on that advisory board or advisory committee. Before Ana Sandoval became a councilwoman, she sat on that as well. And so we were able to provide input and oversight over the air quality work that was being performed at ACOG. So nobody's funding that anymore. So that's an issue we have, right? People are paying for the air quality monitors, are paying for staff time, for studies, but nobody's paying for a mechanism for public input and oversight.
So, I'm sorry, the oil and gas are paying for monitoring.
No, CPS Energy is paying for the air quality monitors.
In Bexar County.
In Bexar County, right, for 7 of them.
Okay. And the oil and gas company will pay for?
For staff time and for studies. Then the thing is, that the funding that the governor vetoed, so the governor vetoed all this near non-attainment area air quality funding just a few months ago. And when he did that, the Air Improvement Resources Advisory Committee and Technical Committees were dissolved, effectively, because there was no more funding for them. But we were going to lose a lot of this other stuff, and that's why the air quality monitors were being turned off. But we were going to lose that funding anyway on October 1st or 2nd, as soon as we were declared non-attainment, because the money we were getting from the state was for near non-attainment areas. Mm-hmm. Going forward, once you get declared non-attainment, you're not eligible for that money anymore. We were going to have to find funding anyway. The more we get it at the local level, the better, because then we can control, we get to decide what emissions we're going to look at and what we're not. But there is money available for non-attainment areas through the state, but But right now, all that money's been committed to Dallas and Houston because they're already in non-attainment. And they're not going to want to give any of that money up. And they've, you know, there's a several-year planning process for what are we going to do? And so a lot of those dollars have already been committed to other issues in other strategies in Houston and Dallas.
Besides that, EPA has announced with the new administration that they're cutting off all grants. They're not funding any more studies. I think one study had just made it in under the wire and was approved, but then they got a letter saying, you have to rewrite your proposal. You're going to get the money, but you have to rewrite your proposal and remove the phrase climate change everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Positions.
It sounds like, Governor, who's the governor in Florida?
Rick Scott.
Rick Scott. I almost said Scott Walker. That guy was over in Wisconsin. Yeah, Rick Scott, yeah. Sounds like Rick Scott's working over there.
Well, I think a whole bunch of governors, including ours, who was the Attorney General, only Larry. You know, I mean, the whole picture is very clear.
Sure. So I'm going to do a little bit of a deeper dive in the Eagle Ford Shale. We flare in the Eagle Ford Shale. Did anybody ever read that San Antonio Express News 4-part series on the flaring and emissions venting in the Eagle Ford Shale? It was fantastic.
The last person to read it was Barry Smitherman, who was head of the Railroad Commission at the time, because he said that at a function here.
Did he?
Yeah. He hadn't heard of it.
Well, so flaring occurs in the Eagle Ford Shale up to 6 times higher than the state average. In some counties, it was found that 30% of the usable gas was burned. In 2012 alone, that was about kind of the peak of Eagle Ford Shale. We had 15,000 tons of air pollutants from flares. And between 2014 and 2015, enough gas was wasted and that could have heated all the homes in San Antonio right in the valley for 2 years. So there's a lot of waste over there. And so now I'm going to talk about the connection between that and climate change. So climate change is going to lead to more extreme weather events, right? Hurricanes is one that we've been following closely recently with Harvey. Did anybody see one of the reasons that Harvey picked up was going to shed so much rain?
The warm water.
And so when you hear people talking in opposition to climate change, or they don't think it's a big deal, right? They say, oh, 2 degrees, who cares? No big deal, right? Well, the surface temperatures of the Gulf were 2 degrees warmer. And so because of that, a lot more water was evaporating off the Gulf. And so climate change did not create Hurricane Harvey. It just contributed to the heavier rainfall, the extreme rainfall.
Makes them more pronounced.
What's that?
Makes it more pronounced.
Right, it made it more pronounced, absolutely. So there are different greenhouse gases. A lot of people hear about your carbon footprint, greenhouse gases, right? Mostly people talk about carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is a long-lived climate pollutant, right? So carbon dioxide is very stable. It'll stay in the atmosphere and without reacting to things for a long time. And it's going to dictate how much the Earth is going to warm by. But then there's short-life climate pollutants. So methane is a very important one. And methane is an extremely potent climate pollutant. So it's going to dictate how quickly we're going to rise in temperature because it traps heat so much better than carbon dioxide. So we need to reduce both methane and carbon dioxide to protect people on our planet. I'm going to stall here because I'm mistaken. Yeah. So what is methane? Anybody?
CH4.
What is CH4?
It's
natural gas, right? So it's kind of like saying water and H2O, right? H2O is the pure chemical form. Water is H2O, and it might have some trace minerals in it, right? There's hard water, there's soft water, right? So methane is pure CH4, it's pure natural gas, but when natural gas comes out of the ground, it's going to have other trace gases in it, right? But essentially, it's the same thing. So what you use to cook on your stove. So here is a picture of some battery tanks. And does anybody see a methane leak there? See a methane leak in this picture? Yeah, you can see a methane leak. But there it is with an infrared camera, and you can see those gases venting over here. So one huge challenge in controlling methane leaks is you can't see them. Just like if we go back, you know, when you cook with natural gas, everybody's had one encountered a stove where you turn it on and then the little igniter's not working or the pilot light's out, right? And you can hear it, but you don't see it, right? And so you have to go to lighter, or you have to click again and get it to light, right? But you can't see it. That's the bottom line. You can't see the leak there. And so when you have an oil spill, you know, it's an environmental disaster. It's a problem. But at least people see it, and they go and they send some environmental cleanup team to address it, right? When you have a methane leak, people don't see it unless you have a $100,000 camera to take that infrared image. You don't see it. And so it just blows away in the wind, and it's gone. And it's like, oh, no problem here, right? It's not getting addressed. That's the challenge.
Mario, I can tell you, you can now get an infrared camera for $500.
You can, but it's not going to see the methane. So there's all kinds of different infrared cameras. Yeah.
They say they've got one you can download on your phone, too.
So those infrared cameras are probably going to see different temperature differences, but they're not going to see the differences in here that you're looking at here. If there was, believe me, I would have EDF buy me one. So a challenge is that we don't have enough inspectors in our state, right? So if you look at TCEQ, so TCEQ's job is to protect public health, right? And so if you, like, remember the flares? If you're flaring, that's fine, but if the flares are smoking too much, that's not okay. Then, so the TCEQ is going to regulate that, right? And so there are over 850 active wells in the state of Texas per inspector, and they're spread out all over the place, so they can't get to them all, right? The Railroad Commission also regulates oil and gas, but their job is to make sure that we're not wasting or destroying natural resources. So if you're going to flare too much gas, or if you're going to vent, they're going to decide how much you can before they just say, you know what, that's being wasteful. So if you're flaring too much, or you're waste, or you're venting too much, they're going to regulate that. And there are over 1,000 active wells per Railroad Commission, Railroad Commission inspector. But keep in mind, that's just the active wells, right? There are tons of inactive wells out there. Some of them we don't even know where they're located. They're not marked. That could be leaking as well. So what has EDF done to address these issues? Well, we started a program called Neighbors Oil and Gas, where we went down into the Eagle Ford Shale. And what we would do is we would host these workshops for people who live or work near oil and gas wells or activities. And we would teach them, what are the potential health hazards from living or working around these activities? What are the signs to look for? And who are the proper state agencies to report them to? Because it can be really confusing. I just barely touched on the difference between the Railroad Commission and the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. Because, for instance, Texas Commission on Environmental Quality has jurisdiction over refined oil and gas. Railroad Commission has jurisdiction over unrefined. So what if you have a spill of partially refined? Right? It's, you know, there's a lot of gray areas here. And if you talk to an inspector from the Railroad Commission or the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, they will tell you half of their job is just understanding what is my job and what is the other agency's job. That's what they spend half their time on.
Sometimes they have to get together on the site to decide.
They do.
Together what's going to be done.
Sure. And then, so then another challenge is the booms and busts of the oil and gas economics, right? Because if there's a boom, all those inspectors, they're being hired by the oil and gas companies to go do oil and gas work. So they don't have, so there's a lot of activity and not a lot of inspectors, right? So that's a big challenge right there. So yeah, we would teach communities what to look for and how to file complaints. That was important because it helped the state agencies prioritize site inspections, right? If people are paying attention, the people who live and work around there are paying attention to this, and they see signs that they think there's potentially some kind of leak going on, and they call up the proper agency, that agency now can send their inspector to these. If they're getting more calls about one site, they're more likely to send their inspectors to that site. That was our strategy that we were trying to implement with this program.
For pipeline leaks?
What's that?
For pipeline leaks?
Not just pipelines, any facility. It could be, yeah, it could be a drilling site, it could be a storage, it could be a processing site, any of that.
How successful was that program?
It's hard to say because of the boom and bust cycle, right? It's really hard to say.
Well, my experience is that if people understand exactly what a violation is, and they can properly describe it when they call into the TCQ, they will get a response. But not everything needs to be reported, and so they can a person can develop a reputation of just always complaining, and then they'll write you off. So being a credible reporter is very important. And my experience has been, at least from the Corpus Christi region, they've been very responsive.
Right.
But they will also say, they can't go out and just drive down the highway and start looking for dirty flares and go tell them you're out of compliance. They have to wait for somebody that's going to be impacted by that to make a complaint. And then they're justified in going out.
So one big challenge here is the mission of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. Does anybody know what their mission is? Their mission statement?
Be quiet.
Somebody said. No, they actually have two missions. One is to protect the public's health, and the other is to ensure economic prosperity of the state.
Right.
Right? And so when does one win out over the other? In my experience, it's probably the economics often wins out, but it's a limited view of economics, right? Because, I mean, it's very short-sighted. So specifically on methane, I showed you some of those methane links and how you can't see them, but methane is 84 times more potent than carbon dioxide, and that's why methane really has a huge impact. It's 25% of the man-made global warming we're experiencing today is caused by methane emissions. It's not all oil and gas. Oil and gas is the top, is the largest source of methane emissions. The second is agriculture, so it could be like beef production, right? So anyway, but that's why if we can get methane emissions under control, we can actually have an impact on climate change in our lifetime. And that's one really important point. So there's two different links between methane, which is a greenhouse gas, and air pollution. So climate change leads to harmful air pollution, right? Because when we have more extreme heat, we're going to burn a lot more fossil fuels to run our air conditioning, right? Or we're going to burn a lot more fossil fuels or wood even in our wood-burning stoves or whatever to heat our homes with more extreme colds, right? More extreme winters. But methane from oil and gas pollution also often comes with other harmful pollutants, right? Like I said, it was like water and H2O, there's methane and natural gas and methane. It doesn't come out of the ground all by itself in a pure form. Like sometimes hydrogen sulfide is something that a lot of people are concerned about. It's an extremely toxic gas. And it's naturally forming, and just depending on where you're actually getting your natural gas from, it may be naturally high in hydrogen sulfide, it may not be. So San Antonio and climate change. Last year we passed our first sustainability plan. Do you guys remember that passing? Yeah. I guess it was in the paper a lot because there were a couple of issues that really stood out that got pulled at the last minute. There was the impervious cover regulations, right? Did we want to have enforcement measures on it, or did we want to make them incentives? And then there was the dark skies stuff as well. So it was in there for a lot of that. One thing that really jumped out to me about our sustainability plan was, and that's not it. It included climate change adaptation, did not include greenhouse emissions reduction targets. So there's climate change mitigation and adaptation. Adaptation is we're trying to adapt, okay? The climate's changing. So what do? We build more levees, do we more drainage ditches, right? How do we, more trees to protect us, you know, so we have a tree canopy and try and keep our cities cooler. But then it's the mitigation. Mitigation is reduce the effects of climate change by reducing our greenhouse gas emissions, right? So we don't want to make it worse. And the the sustainability plan that we had, it had, I think it was 23 community indicators. How are we going to measure our success? And you would go down, and some of them are, you know, how much parkland do we have? It might be how much of CPS's energy that they produce is produced by renewable energy. And they set specific targets for the year 2040 on all of those, right? On 22 of the 23. On the 23rd, it was greenhouse gas emissions, and the target was to be determined. So there's a huge gap there in our sustainability plan. And so that's why we need a climate action plan. So we just had a huge turnover at city council, right? We got a new mayor, we got how many new city council members? Five new city council members? Well, does the six include the mayor? Changing over to six. No, six maybe.
Six out of ten city council members.
Six out of ten city council members and the mayor changed over. So we have very different city council that we're looking at. And on the first day where they were all sworn in, or I guess they were sworn in the night before, the first day that they took office, they said that they are going to, they passed a resolution in support of the Paris Climate Agreement and supporting all of the goals of the Paris Climate Agreement, right? Mm-hmm. And then shortly afterward, an announcement was made that CPS Energy is giving $500,000 to UTSA to help develop a climate action plan. My understanding is that Doug Melnick, our chief sustainability officer with the city, is going to be in charge of the development of the climate action plan, and there's going to be a partnership. And so I have been, and Peter has, and several other people in our community has been part of this climate action environmental leaders coalition who have been meeting, and we've been asking to make sure that this development of a climate action plan, that it will have opportunities for meaningful public engagement so that it will be a community-driven climate action plan. Everybody so far has been saying, yes, we're going to do that. But we don't, what meaningful public engagement means to me might not be the same thing that it means to them. And so we're still in those discussions. Nothing's been finalized. Go ahead.
There's a big difference between climate action and climate adaptation.
Right.
And I hope it will be action rather than adaptation.
It may be both, but we want to make sure that there is climate mitigation. So we're reducing, definitely a huge component of it's going to be reducing our greenhouse gas emissions.
And it seems to me that adaptation is going to include, and I think it already does, since we can't touch what's happening in the Eagle Ford Shale, and it's going to keep happening, and we're getting the brunt of it, then we have to adapt and figure out ways to counteract that.
Well, I'm glad. So one is to counteract, but do we have an opportunity to do anything there or not?
Well, I think if we put pressure on legislators, yes.
That's one way. I'm going to get to another way. So what can you do, right? You can turn off the lights when you're not using them, turn off devices when you're not using them, ride the bus, advocate for public transportation. Anybody know how much money VIA gets here out of our taxes?
They got more.
1/8%
percent?
They get a half a cent, right, out of that. There's a total, right, of 8.25 cents, maybe,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so they get 1/2 of that cent.
Other cities get
1 full cent, mm-hmm. Right? So we're very underfunded compared to other cities in Texas. So advocate for more investment in public transportation, but ride a bike, walk, don't buy disposable products, reduce, reuse, recycle, right? So that's what we can do in our own lives, right? But Sister Elizabeth was bringing up an issue. Can we do anything in the Eagle Ford Shale? Oh, wait. So, yeah, I dropped that one. Support a climate action plan and air quality initiatives here. Ask for a reasonable timeline. I'm glad I put that in there. So Austin developed a climate action plan recently. I think they did it in 2014. It took them 9 months to do it. We're being told right now that it's going to take us 2 years to develop ours, right? And then people, when we get pushback on it, they say, well, it doesn't mean we can't do anything in the meantime. Sure, it doesn't, but I mean, are we going to take this seriously or not? And, you know, we just saw what can happen with things like, with Hurricane Harvey, you know, we dodged a bullet there. But you also saw that 52 people here a year die because of our air quality. So we shouldn't, if we can do it at a faster pace, we should.
When did Austin get their climate action?
I think it's 2014. I'd have to double check on that. So what else can we do? CPS Energy presents us, I believe, with an opportunity, right? Because they can, well, CPS Energy is the largest energy public utility in the nation. And so we buy a lot of natural gas. When you use natural gas in your home, whether it's for you know, your stove or your water heating or heating your home, that you're buying that from CPS Energy. When you turn on your electricity, some of that electricity is coming from a natural gas burning power plant through CPS Energy, right? So they purchase huge amounts of natural gas. And so if we could get CPS Energy to increase transparency and opportunities for public engagement, that would be really great. If we could get them to change their public messaging on natural gas. If you go to CPS Energy's website right now and look at the section on natural gas, what do you think you see? How do you think they describe natural gas? It's clean burning, it's an environmentally friendly energy source, right? So when I think of that, I think, oh, well, it must be as good as solar and wind, right? But that's not quite the case. So we just want them to be honest and show the full picture. Just like when we asked for the economic study and we said, don't just show what it's going to cost industry, show what the health benefits are. Same thing from CPS Energy. Don't just talk about how it's better than coal. Talk about the climate impacts as well, right? And it's cleaner burning. That's great. Okay, but there's some climate impacts. So can we see the whole picture?
What I say to people when they say, but it's so much cleaner than coal, I say, well, come with me and I'll show you what it takes to get it out of the ground.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And that's where the pollution
sure,
happens.
Right, it can, right? And so the Environmental Defense Fund's position on this is we're not trying to stop oil and gas production. We just want them to use best practices. Because there are some good operators out there and there's some sloppy operators out there. They're out there cutting corners, they're looking to get rich quick. Maybe they don't know any better. But we need them to follow best practices. And CPS Energy has the ability, as a huge consumer of natural gas, as a huge customer of theirs, to be able to be able to influence the market. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
So, I like the phrase best practices, mm-hmm. and I'm wondering, does EDF publicize what they believe are best practices, or does the industry have established best practices? Because CPS Energy, as a buyer,
right.
If they say we want best practices, there have to be some standard for us to
those standards exist and we promote them.
Well, and that's how the hamburger industry changed, because when people found out the different ways that beef was raised and slaughtered, it took a few years, but they managed to pressure the hamburger companies to change who they bought from.
Right.
And all that stuff.
So so we have some work to do. Right?
So CPS Energy could, if they only bought from people that had less leaky
if they started by just changing their public messaging on how they see natural gas, that would send a market signal. That tells the oil and gas companies, oh, wait, look, a huge customer of ours actually cares about this. We should start paying more attention to it. You know, when a huge customer does something, you know, the providers will listen. They're going to pay attention because they want to keep those customers. So we can use their leverage as the largest public utility in the nation to do something.
Well, Mario, another way is through investments.
Mm-hmm.
And most people don't realize that there are, in this country, groups of investors that have gotten together, and they're called socially responsible investment coalitions.
Sure.
And they actually go to shareholders meetings, like they forced Exxon to divulge how much they passed a resolution, I think, by 67%, and they never get resolutions passed so much, but they proposed that Exxon would disclose to them at their next shareholders meetings how much money their noncompliance cost the shareholders. That's very powerful because that's one thing they've listened to.
Right.
So,
what's the name of the coalition?
Well, here it's called the Socially Responsible Investment Coalition in San Antonio. We can talk about that in a session.
So, and then I want to touch on one other thing because I know a lot of people are like, well, let's just stop. You know, because I mentioned we're not trying to stop oil and gas production. We want them to use best practices. And some people want to stop it altogether and say, let's just do all solar and wind. And even if we could do all solar and wind tomorrow, we have to understand that they would continue oil and gas production because the soles in my shoes are made from oil and gas products, right? Julie's lid to her water, even though it's a metal water bottle, that lid is made from oil and gas products, right? The protective case on this cell phone is from oil and gas products. Our dashboard, our steering wheels, like, there's so many products that, like, if you look at natural gas.
Medical devices.
Yeah. medical device.
That's what you're using fuel.
People, this would really surprise you, but natural gas, it's a gas, right? But it's used as a feedstock to make solid and liquid products. And so even if we stopped using oil and gas for energy, we're going to continue to use them for so many of these products that we use. And so...
Yeah, but that's like saying, nicotine is a great insecticide. That's why people keep smoking.
Well, my point is, instead of telling CPS Energy right now, use all solar and we want to move in that direction, but also because we're buying natural gas, let's try and influence the market in a way that reflects our values, right? We own them, it's our utility, and so why don't we use that market leverage in a way that reflects our values? Go ahead.
But I think you also didn't mention yet, maybe we're going to, you know, when CPS did their offering of all these different solar incentives where you could go pay $2,500 per panel and then you don't have to pay your bill for 12 years or, you know, basically that's how it works out. I mean, they were sold out immediately.
Right.
You know, they have a wait list.
Sure.
So there's a lot of just meeting the demand for people who are already willing to invest in that among their own customers would be
right.
good because it was like, okay, we're offering this one time. They were overwhelmed with response. How about expanding the program?
Right. So CPS Energy has actually been great on their solar rebates. I'm not a solar expert, but people have told me that we've had some of the best rebates in the country. So much that it was actually a problem that a lot of con artists basically became solar installers here. And so it got to the point where CPS had to change. They had to come up with a list of who was certified and who wasn't because people were taking advantage of. And these installers were just trying to gobble up and take, they were price gouging and taking all the extra profit because of those rebates. But we have had a great, CPS Energy has been great on their solar rebates, and we should encourage them to continue to do that.
This may not be a good idea for the kind of CPS, but I love this covered parking out here. There's really a solar cell at the top. Mm-hmm. And I've often said, why don't parking, at least the new shopping centers have covered parking in Texas? In Texas, I think anybody would go to the shopping center that has covered parking because your car is so hot in the summer, you don't get back in it. And so if they had covered parking and they had solar cells, they could power their shopping center and provide covered parking for their customers. I think their business would increase.
Okay. Well, if you build that place, I'll invest in it. Like you were talking about socially responsible development.
You'll invest in it.
Sounds like you have a future as a developer.
The CPS has been meeting with us quarterly so that they are open to our suggestions.
Yeah, so CPS Energy has been meeting with a group of environmental stakeholders quarterly, and that is great. But they also have a citizens advisory committee that isn't open to the public, and so that could be improved. So, like, if you look at Austin Energy, they have a citizens advisory committee, and there are members of the public that are appointed to that advisory committee, and they produce they post meeting agendas 72 hours before they meet. They post meeting minutes from the previous meetings. They have opportunities for you to sign up for citizens to be heard where the public can speak. Austin Energy does it, San Marcos' Public Utility does it, SAWS does that. CPS Energy, if you're appointed by a council member to sit on their citizens advisory committee, you sign a non-disclosure agreement and then you go meet in secret. And that's it.
Why is that?
I don't know why that is. But that's something that we could open up because imagine if they were to allow citizens to be heard, you all could go, now you've seen this presentation, you could go show up at it and sit and talk about how you care about some of these issues. If any of these resonated with you, you could, and they could see that we care about that. But we're not, there's a firewall there, and we're not allowed to engage in that way.
What is CPS Energy had a second advisory group, the Blue Ribbon Committee, and I was on that committee. And it was dissolved when Doyle Benevey came in as CEO of CPS.
Okay.
But it was the people's version of the advisory committee.
Gotcha.
And there's always the citizens deciding in the area that they're going to get together and form their own citizens advisory committee and then talk to each other and then go to city council meetings or write letters to the editor and then make your ideas public in other avenues.
Well, I think one thing that we really all need to address is that the city council citizens to be heard, you know, since they moved it to B session, they don't keep minutes, they don't have a quorum. I mean, there's basically no citizens to be heard. I was just, you know, I went there a year and a half ago, and took my proposal for an ordinance, just for them to stop planting invasive species on city-owned land, city-controlled land, et cetera. I've brought this up to council members many times. And I thought, well, if I go to citizens to be heard, at least it will be in the minutes, even if they flee. It was pouring rain. I mean, I walked in, and the water was sheeting off me so bad, even after I shook my raincoat out. When they announced citizens to be heard, all the council members looked at me and said, oh my gosh, it's raining. You think, well, it was 95% chance of rain today. I mean, obviously, at some point it's going to rain. And they look up, and 10 of them ran out of the, well, not 10, 8 of them ran out of the room. And Joe Gallagher's assistant and Alan Warwick stayed there. And at one point, one other council person came in. And so I go through all this, and I say this, I think, you know, at least it's going to go in the minutes. No, the only thing that shows up in the minutes now is the name.
Oh.
Because, and they don't have a quorum, so it's not official.
Right.
Because before, at least if you went and spoke to someone, you know, and I will say, you know, Alan Martin listened. I said, well, at least one person listened. But it's not even in the minutes or anything.
That's a derailment policy.
Yeah. It is.
Yeah. Okay, so that is all I have, but I'm still open to taking more questions.